Hello, friends. Robert Bevan here, author of the Caverns and Creatures series of comedy fantasy novels and short stories. With me is Sam West, and today is another Martial Monday. We are now delving into the world of the barbarian. And
Time to
to
get
begin,
angry.
yes, it's time. To begin that journey, we're going down the path of the Ancestral Guardian.
Indeed. This is for barbarians who draw their ancestral guardians. Some barbarians hail from a culture that revere their ancestors, and these tribes teach the worries of that past linger in the world as mighty spirits. This has a lot of good flavor built in, and I know people like it.
Okay. Is
It's
there a butt
something.
coming?
There is a butt coming. I don't love this option, but that's okay. It's fine. It is barbarians as a class. Whenever I'm looking at their subclasses, I'm going, okay, barbarians get to do things. It's rage and hit stuff. Does this give them anything else to do? Like, anything. I'll take jump faster or harder or stronger. I'll take, like, they are better at breaking objects to get into places. I'll take they can, like, I don't know. It doesn't require much for me to get on board the barbarian subclass. I just need them to get something to do that isn't rage. And this is where
well,
I get into some
this is
issues.
Not it.
Sure isn't. So ancestral protection is the third level feature you get. And most barbarians get, like, their subclass sort of gives them an empowerment to their rage. And that's fine. I expect that. And this one is, starting when you choose this path third level, spectral warriors appear when you enter your rage. While you're raging, the first creature you hit with an attack on your turn becomes the target of the warriors, which hinders its attacks. Which isn't... Until the start of your next turn, the target is disadvantaged on any attack roll that isn't against you, and when the target hits a creature other than you with attack, that creature has resistance to the damage dealt by the attack. The effect on the target ends early if your rage ends. Mechanically, I like what's happening here. I think this is a neat defensive barbarian option as like a pseudo-taunt kind of deal, right? Where you run in, you have resistance to non-magical bludgeoning, slashing, piercing damage, or just bludgeoning, piercing, one of the two. You have resistance to some damage. You start hitting some stuff, and those things have to basically hit you back ineffectively. They're not going to be as effective at hitting other things. A lot of the time, they're going to want to hit you anyway. So
yes,
then you're kind of like,
because you
this
are
doesn't
a
do
giant screaming man who's beating on them.
Yeah, usually mostly naked. Sometimes entirely naked. And that's, you know, as we know about, what was it, the Scots? They did the blue paint, fully nude, charge into battle strategy. It was incredible.
You got a bunch of tats to show off, too.
That's also true. So, like, it all comes full circle with this as far as if this was with something else, if this had like a third level other option that you could use these ancestral warriors in other cool ways, I'd be a little bit more interested in this. I don't really get the flavor, to be entirely honest with you. At the warriors hindering attacks, that just feels like you're goading things and like you're scaring them. Like they're less effective at attacking other things than you because they focus on you. It doesn't really feel like I've got a bunch of warriors that, like warriors, spectral warriors that are like floating around me. And now they're just like throwing up shields, I guess. And like, you know, parrying, but not like locking hits, just like slowly sliding to the left. I don't understand what's happening.
I don't, yeah, all right, here's how I see it. These are your ancestors. Why are they protecting everyone but you?
It's right. It's weird.
Yeah.
This to me feels like it was a feature on a different paladin subclass. And they're like, this is really boring. We need to make this interesting. Let's call whatever's happening here a spectral warrior defense. And there's nothing else. It's like, it's just this, which I'm left going, okay, so... In some instances where it's protecting your allies, that's cool. That's not often, and that isn't nearly enough for a third level feature. Like, that's all you get. There's nothing else. Like, nothing. You get exactly zero things. So that's not a great place to start. Sixth level gives us a spirit shield. So this is beginning of sixth level. The guardian spirits aid... the guardian spirits that aid you can provide supernatural protection to those you defend. If you are raging and another creature you can see within 30 feet of you takes damage, you can use a reaction to reduce that damage by 2d6. And then when you reach certain levels in this class, you can reduce it by more. 3d6 at 10th level and 4d6 at 14th level.
All right. Now, let me make this clear. This also cannot affect you.
Correct.
My ancestors suck.
They just really want you to die
yeah.
in glorious combat and join them, Bob. That's
yeah.
the objective,
wow.
is to become one with them through death. They don't, they're, you're not worthy of protecting. Your job is to keep everyone else alive who's inferior to you, and you get to, like, you know, you're proud, you're with your ancestors, they're giving you, you're, they're not giving you anything. They're just helping you defend others. I don't get the fantasy here at all.
Yeah, this feels like your dad who berates you in front of your friends.
Yes, that's exactly what this is your dad's just being like, I'm just saying, Timmy's mom said he got an A on his last test, and you definitely got a C, so why can't you be more like Timmy? And Timmy's like, thanks, Mr. B, and you're just over there bleeding on the ground.
I do like the mechanic on this one, though. It's a, you know, if you got nothing else to do with your reaction, you can say, hey, have some hit points back. And, you know, 2d6 is not nothing. That can completely negate a hit. I mean, what are we at? Sixth level now?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe not a whole hit, but...
close to a hit. And it's every round, too, right? So reducing, like, 3 enemy attacks in a round, even at, like, at its... And it scales with the game, so it goes to 3d6 and 4d6, which is meaningful. And that, very crucially, I despite how awful this option is, it had the dignity of not making its upper-level features, you get a bonus d6 to your spirit shield, which we've seen other options...
Yes.
not have the good nature of doing. So, like, at least they built the scaling into the feature. I do think this is probably the most interesting feature they have. I like this in, like, alongside a paladin. I like this alongside a fighter and a monk, right? If you're playing a group that's predominantly, like, aggressors that are want to be in melee range, this sort of sets the archetype up as a, I will lead a frontline group of assailants, and we're all going to be hard to deal with, and we're all going to be threatening. And if anything attacks my friends that we're tag teaming, they're going to have a worse time than if they attack me. And if they attack me, it's probably a positive because I get to use my resistances. And that's kind of like a cool little play pattern it's kind of trying to establish. Does it succeed? No. I don't think this option, like, actually has a great play pattern at tables once it gets down to it, just because of how little impact Ancestral Practice will have on the average fight, and how Spirit Shield, like, it sounds good in a vacuum to be like, oh, anything the time anyone else takes damage, as long as they're within 30 feet of me, I can reduce that damage. You have to be raging. You have to be able to see the ally, which isn't always given. You have to have... if for this reaction to be available at all, something other than you has to take damage, and again, we've already established the goal of this is to be the option that is taking the damage. So if you have a bunch of backlines...
I was going to say, the Ancestral Protectors are encouraging the attackers to attack you, which, I mean, yeah, more than one person can be attacked in a fight. But, I don't know. It seems to be going opposite directions.
Yeah, and it's like, I get the intent and the aim of it. I don't know if it's like landing that successfully is doing anything that meaningful. And again, you don't do anything else, right? Like, this is a defensive, like, kind of like, oh, things still hit me. That's the objective. And if things hit other things, they take a little bit less damage. Okay, that's like an in combat, some kind of other reaction that's somewhat defensive. That's technically something. But like, there isn't... this isn't bringing a barbarian into any new spaces. This isn't taking barbarian to say that you're like, you are able to impact the world in a different fashion than most other barbarians are kind of able to do. And I don't love that so far. 10th level consult
next.
Yeah, consult the spirits, which is the first like out of combat utility feature, which is I'm amazed they got any. A lot of these don't. So at 10th level, you get the ability to consult with your ancestral spirits. When you do so, you're going to love this. You can cast the augury or clairvoyance spell without using spell slot or material components. Rather than creating a spherical sphincter, the clairvoyance invisibly summons one of your ancestral spirits to the chosen location. Wisdom is a spell casting ability modifier for these spells. After you cast either spell in this way, you can't use this feature again until you finish a shorter long rest. So it's like a short rest pack magic version of clairvoyance / augury as the same spell.
Now, the big question here is, does clairvoyance still take 10 minutes to cast?
Sure does.
Don't love that.
Me neither. I'm not high on either of these spells. And this is happening at 10th level?
We know my
level?
Feelings about augury.
Yeah. This is happening 5 levels after characters have had 3rd level spell slots. And you get it once per short rest.
This is... You're never using this.
You're using this very infrequently. I think you're probably using augury a decent amount because it only has a 1 minute cast time. And that's still not like a particularly good spell to get. Like, we've seen first level features that give it access to augury, right? Like, they realize they overshot the power level of that spell. It's probably not worth a second level slot, especially because it's kind of like a, is this a good idea kind of spell? And like, as a 10th level feature, if that's what you're predominantly using it for, I don't love that.
No.
And like clairvoyance only lasts 10 minutes and has a 10 minute cast time. So like I guess it kind of opens you up to be a scout kind of character where you're sending your clairvoyant spirits around to like see, generally speaking, places around you. But it's like in place. So you have to be like pick a location and go, okay, we've been to that room, or I know we should be going into that room. I'll put a clairvoyance in there if you give me 10 minutes, and that doesn't seem.
And then you're gonna hang around 10 minutes while you're checking it out. We don't have to, but yeah, I don't know. Go watch our clairvoyance video.
It's a bad spell.
Break down why that's so not great.
I think this could be at will, and I would have the exact same opinion of it.
Yeah, I'd still just not be using it.
Yeah,
they give you, you know, long or short rest. I always like those words. But for abilities that I don't care about and that I'm not using anyway, yeah, this isn't the one I want to see those words on.
I honestly would have been like, just cut clairvoyance and put this at third level with ancestral protectors, and I think we'd have a very different conversation on our hands. As a 10th level feature?
I don't like its effect on the game. I don't like that it exists.
For what it's worth, I also don't think augury is that good for the game. I think it's a cute magical appearance, which I think is why I tend to give it a lot more slack than a lot of the other things I hate, is because it does the magic part of it pretty well for me. Mm-hmm. You know, you bring out laying out cards, or you do some kind of occult ritual, roll some bones or whatever. Clairvoyance has no excuses. Clairvoyance is just hot trash. I say that, like, barbarians need out of combat things to do, and this technically counts. And I will say, going from having nothing to this is a meaningful upside. It will give you some more to do than you had prior. It's not a good thing to do, though. It's still not, like, a new, powerful, useful tool that you haven't seen characters opt not to use since fifth level. Like, there will be characters in your party that could have added access to these two spells and won't take them because they're bad five levels before you get the privilege of learning them, which is sad and a bit of a bummer. And also, maybe you're not on wisdom. Maybe you're like, wisdom's your dump stat, and then this is,
yeah, and you're a barbarian.
I mean, it's still not that.
If you were wise, you might have a better job.
You would have picked a better subclass.
You might not be so angry all the time.
Also that. So the last 14th level feature is vengeful ancestors. When at 14th level, your ancestral spirits grow powerful enough to retaliate, which frankly took them long enough.
Yeah, seriously.
When you use your spirit shroud to reduce damage of an attack, the attackers take an amount of force damage that your spirit shroud prevents. So it does 46 reflective damage now. And that's kind of cool. And the spirit shroud is the best feature here. So like, okay, you get a little, like every round I do a little 46 bonus damage sometimes. And if things, you know, neat.
Yeah, but is it neat enough to justify a 14th level feature?
No, this option doesn't have nearly enough content for me to take it as a barbarian. I think if you want, and like, I don't even think it does a good job delivering the fantasy it's promising. Like, I don't, who wants this then? If it is both weak mechanically, which it is, it has one good feature, right? And that's Spirit Shroud. And that's not like,
shield.
Not a game warping feature. Sorry, that one. Spirit Shield.
Yes.
Spirit Shroud's a shell.
Yeah.
Spell. Yeah,
spell,
yeah,
yeah.
I said shell. I'm also not all here today, Bob. It's great. If Spirit Shield is the only good feature, and it's not by any means like a riveting feature, I think it's probably better than like fighters' protection fighting style, but not by a huge margin, by like a decent amount. That's it. That's the only thing we really majorly care about. Until 14th level? No, thank you. I don't want nothing to do with this.
If I'd feel better about it if Spirit Shield protected you as well, and then you could use this, because I think it would be doing a lot more.
Then you have a little bit more of an interesting question to make, right? As opposed to saying, I saw someone else take damage, I use it. That's currently the state of it. Now you can go, okay, well, I saw them take damage, but I know I've got three things on me, because that's where you expect them to be. You used to be taking those attacks. You can kind of make a cool trade-off. You can say, do I assume I should give this to my ally, or should I save it for me this round, knowing that I'm probably going to take more damage, but they have lower hit points? You get the cute little decision-making options. It doesn't give you that option. You just go, okay, you took damage, great. I'm taking most of the hits anyway, have 2d6, I guess, because I need to use this, because there's no reason not to.
Yeah, because going back to Spirit Shield itself, that was the one. Yeah, like it's a reaction. So I was thinking the choice is, do I use this or do I, you know, hope somebody leaves so I can opportunity attack them? But that's not going to happen because of the first one, Ancestral Protectors.
I will say this. Barbarians really like the Polar Master builds, and this does not work with those, because you really want your reaction to be stabbing something engaging you, which means you're not going to have as many instances to use Spirit Shield. So, like, a known decent quantity on Barbarian doesn't synergize particularly well with this archetype. And this archetype, and Spirit Shield definitely isn't better than that, I don't think.
No.
Sounds like a really, like, there's a cool fantasy here. This is a neat direction to take.
Absolutely. But it just doesn't deliver.
No. Ancestral Protectors is a weird goading feature that I don't like. It's, again, like, thematically, I get it. I like the idea of making paladins that are, they're built to defend more than built to just smash things to pieces. I think that's, there's a neat direction and, like, design premise there that option doesn't deliver on in a meaningful enough way that it, like, works. Spirit Shield is cool. Consult of the Spirits is utter trash. And then we're left with, like, a 40 level feature that you have to sit in a bad archetype for a long time to get access to, and then it's just a little bit more damage per round, which is fine, but still not something that, like, I'm blown away by. It also still doesn't really feel all that, like, you got spiritual, vengeful warriors around you. I would love to see, like, levitate on this. I'd love to see fly on this. I'd love to see light, honestly. Does your, like, you glow. Give me an aura effect. Give me something
more than this. Or some kind of condition on the enemies.
Yep.
Okay.
There had to be more than what this is.
Give me a fear. I mean, if I see a giant barbarian with the spirits of his ancestors flying around him, that's terrifying.
It should be. It's not currently.
Yeah, it should be, yes. This is one of the weakest subclasses we've covered so far, I think.
Yeah, we'd also talked about Purple Dragon Knight. And this isn't that quality. But it is still quite bad. I'm going to grade it a D. I would not play this. I would not recommend you play it. Spirit Shroud saves it from F territory. But that's really not enough for me to get anyone excited to play this, I don't think.
I don't know. If I had this on my character sheet, I don't know if I'd be able to tell the difference between this and a straight-up barbarian.
Especially if you are under 6th level. If you're playing a 5th level barbarian with extra attack, this looks very similar to base barbarian, because in Subtle Practice, there's very little.
D. I'm leaning toward D minus, but I don't know. I'll save the real vitriol for.
There's worse to come. Don't worry.
Yeah. All right. Save it for those. But yeah, I am thoroughly unimpressed with Ancestral Guardians. Choose a different path.
There's a really good one in the Player's Handbook. Take that one instead. And then there's also Berserker. Don't take that one.
We'll get to him.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you, Sam, and thank you, everyone, for joining us. That was Path of the Ancestral Guardian. Let us know what you think down in the comments, and like and subscribe and all that. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you for watching. If you found this helpful, informative, or entertaining, I'd really appreciate it if you hit the like button below. You needn't smash it. A gentle tap will suffice. If you want to see more videos like this, subscribe to the channel. And make sure you check out the links in the description, where you'll find my Caverns and Creatures series of comedy fantasy novels, Sam's full review of the spell, and other fun things.